Hello and welcome to the ProYaki Report, Volume 1, Episode 51, Oryx Trading Company. I'm Michael Westbay, your host. There's been a repeated theme in the newspaper ever since the start of the 2012-2013 off-season. That is, Oryx is interested in pretty much anybody that the other team is releasing. When the Giants announced that they were not going to be picking up Yoshitomo Tani's contract for next season, the Buffalo swept right in and signed their former outfielder, having him return to the Buffaloes for the first time in a 7-year absence. Oryx has also expressed interest in Major League Japanese free agents Tsuyoshi Wada of the Orioles and Munenori Kawasaki of the Blue Jays, as well as pretty much every domestic free agent who has declared. Besides Tani, in slightly over a month since the beginning of the Hot Stove League, the Buffaloes have signed Kenichi Marumo, an Ikse player for the Giants, Esteban Hermon of Cebu, Willimo Peña from SoftBank, and Ryo Sakakibara from Nippon Ham. That's already more than the 3 released players that Oryx signed after the 2012 season. Kodai Matsumoto from Lotte, Jose Fernandez from Nakuten, and Masafumi Hirai from Chunichi. Of the 3, only Hirai has been invited back for the 2014 season. As far as trades go, no team acquired more players during the 2012-2013 offseason through trades than Oryx did. Over the course of 4 transactions, including picking up Takahiro Mahara as a free agent compensation pick, the Buffaloes signed 6 players. In season, they made their 5th trade of the year, sending Makoto Yoshino to SoftBank for Kinsuke Kato just before the trade deadline at the end of July to bring their 2013 trade signings up to 7 incoming players. The very first trade of the 2012-2013 offseason was between Oryx and the Giants. It was a 2-for-2 swap where Oryx got pitcher Shun Tono and infielder Kazunao Yamamoto for a pair of pitchers. Tono had spent most of the 2012 season on the farm for the Giants, where he went 1-6 with a 5.83 ERA, only throwing 1 start at Ichigun, and that being during Interleague. His 6 appearances at Ichigun for Oryx in 2013 were not very impressive, although he did pitch better at Nigun than at Ichigun. Since they've signed him on again for next year, I'm guessing that his Nigun performance was enough for Oryx to keep a hold of him and give him another try. Yamamoto has been a useful utility infielder, playing mostly at shortstop, but also at first and third base when needed. Unfortunately, he doesn't really have the power of a corner infielder, so I don't really think that there's much potential that he's going to stay with the club beyond 2014. Having failed to hit even close to 200 for Cebu in 2012, it was no surprise that the Lions let Hada go at the end of the season. Filling in at second base for Oryx, however, Hada managed to bring his average up to a respectable 253. He makes for a reasonable replacement player in the infield, much more so than Yamamoto, in my humble opinion. As mentioned earlier, the Buffaloes got Mahara as compensation for Hayato Terahara returning to SoftBank as a free agent. Mahara sat out all of the 2012 season with an injury, so it was no surprise that it took until the end of September for Oryx to bring him up to the top team. During his stint at the top team for Oryx, he threw in 3 outings, throwing 1 inning each and going just 1 over the minimum, allowing no runs. If he can stay healthy, Mahara poses a great deal of potential for Oryx's bullpen in the future. The biggest trade news of the 2012-2013 offseason was Nippon Ham trading all-star center fielder Yoshio Itoi to Oryx. Word was that Itoi wanted a guarantee from the Fighters that he would be posted after the 2013 offseason. Instead, the Fighters sent him to Osaka to argue with Oryx's management over his salary and potential posting. While Itoi didn't get too much press in the Kanto area here, not nearly as what he got while he was in Hokkaido, he did continue to put up solid numbers both on offense and defense, and his power numbers also increased while he was with Oryx. Yagi seemed to have been included in the Itoi trade to help offset the three players that Oryx gave up for the all-star center fielder. Unfortunately, Yagi seemed to perform well only on a three-year cycle, 2006, 2009, and 2012. So this was his first of two off-seasons. You know, even his good years have not been anywhere near what they were his rookie year of 2006. So I don't really have much hope that he'll make it up to that third year of 2015 with Oryx. With regards to the mid-season trade of a couple of farmhands, based on their Nigun numbers through the end of July, it looked like the Kato Yoshino exchange had favored SoftBank. However, in the end, Yoshino was released at the end of the 2013 season by SoftBank, and Kato looks like he may have a chance to break through in 2014 for Oryx. In conclusion, for the second year in a row, Oryx appears to be trying to fill their holes by signing players who have some potential that other teams have released, and through trades. This strategy certainly had its pluses and minuses in the 2013 season for Oryx, but I really don't see it as a way of building up a better ball club overall. In fact, I thought that the Buffaloes had done better when they were swapping young players in and out of Ichigun and Nigun a few years ago. And I don't really know if the Hermon and Pena acquisitions are going to be able to fill the hole left by Lee Dae-ho. But Oryx is going to keep going forward with this strategy in hopes of building a better team. I wish them luck with that. And with that, I submit to you this week's Pro Yaku Report. Thank you for joining me, and until next week, take care.